In the late 19th century, Pune itself witnessed the worst ever plague epidemic, when all the Punites had to be evacuated, shifted from their house and relocated. After that, we have witnessed so many epidemics like cholera, typhoid, and not to forget the swine flu a few years back. But since the late 20th century, we have been going through an epidemic of violence against medical professionals. And to discuss on this, we have one very interesting session for which we have two eminent persons as chairpersons. The first one, may I request Dr. K. Sancheti sir to please come on stage. Padma Vibhushan Dr. K. Sancheti, who is a well-known and respected figure in Pune. He is founder, director and chief orthopedic surgeon of Sancheti Institute of Orthopedic and Rehabilitation, which is one of the Asia's top three orthopedic institutes. Sir is honorary professor, examiner, member of several higher level committees and of Government of Maharashtra and Medical Council of India. A man who himself is an institute. He has nurtured more than 300 orthopedic surgeons, and they have been spreading his orthopedic message to all over Maharashtra, not only Maharashtra, all over India. Our second chairperson is Dr. Sanjay Oak. Please, sir, may I request you to please come on stage. Dr. Sanjay Oak is an accomplished pediatric surgeon, vice chancellor of D.Y. Patil University, Navi Mumbai. He is ex-dean of Nair and KM Hospital. He is MS, MCH, FRCS Edinburgh, FMAMS, and of course, winner of Dr. B.C. Roy, which is a very precious award. He is a prolific writer of more than 100 books and speaker par excellence. May I request you, sir, to please start with the session. Thank you.
Namaskar. प्रत्यक्ष परिसंवाद जर इंग्रजीत ना असला तरी पुण्यात यायचं आणि मराठीत प्रारंभ नाही करायचा म्हणजे चिकण्याच्या दुकानात जाऊन बाकरवडी न घेतल्यासारखं होत. पद्मविभूषण संचेती सरांच्या शेजारी बसणं हाच मोठा सन्मान आहे. बट डिअर फ्रेंड्स, वी टेक दिस ऑन अ व्हेरी सॉलेम अँड सिरियस नोट. अँड द एंटायर नेक्स्ट अबाउट अँड अवर अँड हाफ we will be locating and relocating ourselves to find out what actually goes wrong. Dear friends, I have been in clinical surgery for the last 32 years, and I still remember a date, 24th of January 1989, when I was a young lecturer, just past my MCH, working in KM Hospital, where I was beaten up by a boy's father. We had lost the boy, who was admitted at 4 p.m. with provisional appendicitis by 7 p.m. And I knew that certainly I am looking at something apart from appendix. And so did it turn out to be a dissecting aneurysm of aorta. Nobody could have perhaps saved it in 1988. But I was beaten up. And I distinctly remember never having forgot this incident. 3 days down the line, the same father came back to the ward, touched my feet in front of everybody in the ward and said, I'm sorry, it happened in the heat of emotions. While I was the director of KM Hospital and Mumbai's health, dear friends, not even 1 week, and I'm telling you the truth is, not even 1 week has gone where I had not had to go in the middle of the night to the dean's office to pacify agitated residents and calm the relatives and act as a mediator between the two. Moriwada police station had virtually become a second home for us. We knew everybody who was there. My 10 years on the health administration side and now on the university side have given me the best possible friends and colleagues in police force, and I can name a lot of them, apart from Sir, like V. Shivanandan, like Vivek Pansalkar, Rajneesh Seth, so many of them. And have also got the best of friends from the legal side, like Uday, and so many others. So when we corrected about CIILM not only being for doctors, but also for being doctors and patients, I want to go a step ahead and say that it also exists for the legal side. I think let's not make a mistake that doctors are, and lawyers are on the opposite sides. No. We are actually on the same side, and it is ultimately for the betterment of the patient. We must realize that we also need to discipline ourselves. We also realize that we need to choose the right kind of words which we use for communications. And in spite of all these things, the violence, which could range from a slap to a doctor to burning down of 300-bedded hospitals in Thane, which even today stands as a testimony of what happened, there is not even one week that goes when we do not read in the newspapers or hear in the media the news about mob fury and violence. And therefore, I think this particular session is of immense significance to understand what is going wrong. Has the trust been eroded, or has the technology really exceeded the doctor-patient synergy? Whether we are advertising ourselves too much, talking too much that we should not be saying, or not talking when we should be communicating. Whether we are mincing words, at times giving promises which we should not have, and at times when we have not put our friendly hand on the back of a patient's relative to comfort him. In short, are we forgetting our humanitarian aspects of medicine? All those things we'll discuss and find out. And we can't have better group than our police brothers, than our police colleagues, who are there to help us, who are there to tell us what are the provisions of IPC and various other things. As a Vice Chancellor, I have been banging my head on MCIS doors to modify the curriculum of second MBBS of forensic medicine, toxicology and medical jurisprudence. We should be truly talking about today's laws and enactments within which we need to perform. But unfortunately, we are still lying there in slumber. And that is where the role of Dr. Kakde, he's a man possessed. That's the only word that I can use. Every weekend when I come home, I have a regular visitor at 8 p.m. and that is Dr. Kakde to discuss the nuances of legal medicine as a subject and the way to be taken it ahead. I'm very sure that the next 5 or 7 years, will have legal medicine and its various implications being brought into the medical curriculum. And there all these things will come as case studies, as events what happened in different states, the type of decisions that were passed by different benches, the amount of compensation and how poorly we were covered to take care of such compensations. So today we will make an effort. Now the way this has been divided is that there are 3 or 4 very eminent speakers, our colleagues from the police force. We have the highest possible authority today with us. They will say, address you, give you a nucleus of what they want to say. Then we'll all sit together. And there are some case scenarios which have actually happened, either in this city or in the neighborhood. The reactions, there could be opinions on that. So we will evoke their responses and trying to be knowledgeable by about 8 p.m. I now request my idol, Padma Vibhushan Sancheti sir, to say a few words.
Thank you. Very well covered all the points which we face, our patients face, and the legal authorities also face. Open dialogue to interrogate ourselves and to know what should be done, because we have got little control on the opposite side, but we can minimize the undesirable situation by certain ways by which Dr. Oak has spoken in nutshell what are the points, and I'm sure this whole session will enlighten us on these points, and we can come to certain conclusions to follow for every one of us, so that such incidences are reduced and the synergy between the patient and doctor increases as like before. Thank you very much.
Sir, I'm going to request Dr. Sanjay Gupta. There are some of our senior police colleagues who have not yet been able to make it. That's because today is the Shiva Jayanti and there's a lot of significance of day being out in the society. But Dr. Sanjay Gupta is one of us. I always say obstetricians and pediatricians are my professional better halves because I'm a pediatric surgeon. Unless and until they create a baby, I won't be able to operate the baby. So Dr. Sanjay Gupta has been a president of FOCSI, which is a very premier institute in India, has been a president of Diabetes in Pregnancy Study Group, which is another important thing in medicine, national convener of Save the Mother and Newborn National Initiative. Whatever we may say of India's progress, till we get the maternal mortality rate down in two figures, we have not really progressed. So I think that's what Sanjay Gupta is doing. Secretary General of World Gestosis Organization, PCP entity, about which there would be endless opinions, is a member of Central Supervisory Board of this and a chairman of Ethics Committee of Maharashtra Medical Council. Just last week, if you are reading the newspaper, Maharashtra Medical Council has raised issues and has really, really flopped some of the medical colleagues by suspending even their licenses for a few months. I request Dr. Sanjay Gupta to begin this by elaborating on doctor in police station. How do we find ourselves in that location? Dr. Gupta, please.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjay. He's such a great orator that, you know, speaking after him, you know, always is difficult. Yeah. And of course, in front of, you know, Sancheti sir, who is from childhood, you know, we have, you know, there's a story, we used to stay next to each other, and I've seen him studying in college, and that's how we, grew up, you know, old Wada in Narayanpet, you know. So I've seen him from that days and admire him from that day. So it's great to have you, sir, in the chair. And so actually, I'm the replacement speaker today because Mr. Atul Chandra Kulkarni couldn't come because of obviously the Shiva Jayanti commitments that the police department is having today. So I'm supposed to tell you about what happens in the police station. But before that, I would like to tell you just a little story of imagining a young doctor who has, you know, got his admission, you know, after a lot of struggle in the medical college. Now the fees, when we studied, the fees were something like 200 rupees per term. Now there are many lakhs per term. Even in government medical colleges, leave aside the, you know, all the private institutes. Then he struggles through his medical college for, you know, 5 years, internship, then studies all around for all the various kinds of examinations, finally manages to get into the postgraduate course and manages to pass the postgraduate course. After that, what is he supposed to do? He's supposed to start his own practice, which is again prohibitively difficult for him because the cost of getting a clinic is extremely high in a city. Then what we expect him to do, not only, you know, start the clinic like that, but absolutely don't announce, you know, except for the first announcement, no advertisement is allowed, you know, absolutely. And then, you know, they are tempted to get the patients by giving some cut to somebody. He said, no, it's entirely unethical. So what are we supposed to do? You know, he's supposed to just put up a small board with so many, you know, hundreds of senior colleagues around and hope that the patient, you know, just comes to him, you know, by accident, and then he will start, you know, communicating and doing whatever with the patient. Usually the first patients come were very difficult. If you remember your old days of initial practice, the patients who come initially are sometimes fairly difficult. Difficult in a sense, you know, they are the ones who are shop around, they are the ones who want less cost. There are some very clever persons who know that this new doctor is new and you will not go, you know, ask for money and get treated, and then let's see whether I need to pay and all. So all sorts of, you know, basically, you know, initial experiences we all go through. And, you know, God forbid if he ends up with a case, which is a serious case at his doorstep, and suddenly the patient dies, then the whole hell, you know, breaks loose, and then, you know, the there are a lot of people coming around trying to trash him up, taking a complaining against him to the police station, and then the arrest and all those issues. And his reputation is tarnished in the first few years, so poor fellow has to almost give up on his practice. So this is not a very, you know, unimaginable scenario. It's extremely true, and quite a few doctors have, you know, faced this particular scenario. So this is one thing where we come across, you know, the violence. The violence somehow definitely have increased for many reasons. We recently heard of the Alibaug story where surgery was going on, suddenly ventricular fibrillation occurred, and which is, as the doctors would know and others may not, that it's sometimes an unavoidable and unexpected complication, and the patient died, and then the, you know, the patient actually died in another tertiary hospital in ICU. But there also the mob collected. Fortunately, there were some policemen for some other reason in that hospital who tried to protect the doctors. In the meantime, they got injured themselves by the mob. Mob was about 300 to 400. Yeah. And finally, the rapid action force had to be deployed, and the doctors were saved. So it has become even physically threatening, you know, to practice sometimes. There are cases from various, and we can go on. And, you know, why I'm putting up these cases, because the next speaker who was supposed to be here also to give you case scenarios also hasn't reached, so some of that has to be mentioned so as to, you know, go ahead with the further discussion that we are going to have on this. There were particularly, you know, peculiar cases from Kerala, and one of the Kerala doctors recently in a conference presented with pictures and everything. In one of the small cities in Kerala, the doctor advised, patient came with chest pain, and he honestly felt that, you know, something is wrong with the heart. He advised angiography. And when the angiography was done and all, fortunately nothing difficult was found, and he thought that, okay, you know, that was it. The patient's relatives came back and thrashed him up, saying he, we have done unnecessary investigation and we have to pay in this hospital, and he faced the problem. A little away from this city, again a small town in Kerala, the general practitioner was practicing, patient came with fever and has small complaints, and he was treating him for 3 or 4 days. Being a small place, he did not go for too many investigations, only routine things were done. And the patient finally had, you know, some problem which need to be investigated, but before it could he could be sent to tertiary hospital and it was done, the patient died. Again, the relatives came and, you know, thrashed him up, okay, why didn't you do the investigations? You know, that, you know, you should have done the investigations, otherwise, you know, because of that our patient died and all that. So both sides, so, you know, if you do too many, you get in trouble. If you do too less, you get in trouble. And now patients resort to directly violence. Of course, you know, later on, as we discuss, the question is always of communication lack and communication gap. But if the communication is good, and that is, you know, instead of just narrating these various stories, I'll tell you that always, you know, our police department, you know, is definitely of help to us. And that's not, I'm saying just because, you know, Pravinji Dixit is here. But I'll tell you a recent incident in my hospital about a few months back. A baby was born, the patient had come to us only in the 9th month. One of my colleagues were following the patient. And within about 15-20 days, you know, all the investigations were done outside in last minute. As you know, they come from, you know, Sasar Mahir and all that, they had come for the delivery. The baby delivered and the baby had cleft lip. Now, cleft lip is not such a, you know, terrible complication, you know, that cannot be corrected or this thing. But immediately, as, you know, the baby was shown, the relatives immediately started a few gathered together, you know, typical with that gold chains and all that, 7-8 people, and started fighting with the doctor. You know, we have heard your name. We came for your, you know, brand of hospital, and how can this happen? How can this baby have this? They tried to explain to them that this is not something we have created. You know, this was there before, and this. But there was, you know, the argument went on and on, and especially because it was probably a girl. No, then what will happen when she, you know, grows up and there's going to be always a scar, even if you correct and all that. Fortunately, we have the systems and, we have fortunately good contacts also with our police friends, as Dr. Sanjay Oak said. So our administrator called up the police station nearby. And believe me, within minutes, you know, and the police jeep came, 7-8 people just immediately landed in the hospital. The minute that happened, you know, all these people were making all that noise, you know, quiet, and they say, oh, who called the police? No, we didn't mean to complain. You know, immediately the tone went down and this thing. And just I think the matter was sorted out immediately there and then, because the police response was so quick. So always, if you properly, you know, have this contact, and I think it's important that we know around our police station who, you know, which is the police station whom we can contact, and as doctors, I think, yeah, and because sometimes patients can be absolutely unreasonable, like in this case, and there is no question of why and, you know, what, and no explanation was really going to be of health. And some, of course, later on, as it happens, after 3 or 4 days, they realize that they were in the wrong and all that, and usually they nicely took the baby home and even distributed the sweets and all that. But, you know, initially, this reaction can be very difficult, and we have to be all careful about these initial reactions. Many times the questions come up, you know, postmortems, where sometimes the doctors are responsible because postmortem is not done, sometimes they are responsible by their relatives because it is advised, and so forth and so on. So I'm not going to go into all these stories, but we have eminent people to guide us on all this. So this was just a introductory talk on that, and I'm sure we'll be discussing and guiding you all in these various respects in time to come. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Gupte, for setting the ball in motion. He has raised very vital issues. And if I may just take a recap, because we'll take this recap in question and answer with our police colleagues. One of the main issues that we touched upon was advertising and marketing. Sometimes we overdo. And, well, I'm of the opinion that medicine needs to be marketed, but medicine should never be advertised. And that is something which invites trouble to us. He also raised an issue, can we predict by the virtue of your experience in your faculty, you tend to understand that this is a kind of relative, this is a type of relative who will eventually get this into trouble. And I'm sure Uday will also elaborate on this, that in the group, you must pick up the one who is going to invite problems, who is going to invite problems. So many times it is not the immediate relative, but a distant neighbor who incites problems. I must also say that sometimes it is your professional rival next door is also responsible to initiate problems, and let's not do all those things. Can we prophylactically intimate police stations? Can we have a relationship, a very cordial relationship with the local police station where your clinic or hospital is placed? I remember my days as KGM chief. I requested Bhuiwada staff to permanently park the van in the KM campus. Well, it cost me just a parking place for one van, but the amount of sanctity it brought to the campus was something phenomenal. Can we have, this question has been coming to my mind repeatedly, can we have a kind of a hotline connection between your hospital and a neighboring police station, where contact becomes brought, because it is in such situations it is race against time, and therefore how can we reach the police personnel as quickly as possible? It's an age of documentation, it's an age of evidence-based medicine. In my mind, it's an age of evidence-based practice. And should we have video cameras installed all around our hospitals, apart from the areas where we should not be doing for the sake of private persons and the private protection of the patient? should we have, he touched upon a very important point, should we have professionally trained administrators to run the management of the hospital, who are professionally trained to lead into such situations, to do the negotiations with the mob, to face the fury of the mob, to face the media. It's an art in itself. I learned that art at the end of 8 years of my dean's tenure. So I think this kind of thing, just by the virtue of seniority of your clinical things in surgery, you don't become expert in dealing with various aspects like this. In my mind, always it's a question comes on coming, is that we are at times very ad hoc, you know. Should we have standard operating practices available in our clinics? Okay, in the event of a death, what happens? In the event of an accident patient coming up, what should be done? So whether I'm there or not, the system will follow itself and there will be an SOP laid out for each one of such things. And yes, the point that my police colleagues always kept on telling me, Sahib, kaditari control kara yenare maansanjo. Lalbakka Rajaji Ganpati control kele sarkha amala hote. So can we have some system to control the entry and exit? And this is not a situation just for major hospitals. Some of the pediatricians' practice is phenomenal. They have 200 cases, 150 cases, multiply each baby by two relatives, and at least three bystanders who keep on coming and going. And you can, at any time, you may have a crowd of 350 to 400 in that small building. Forget about the violence issue. Very senior police officer Sadanand Date has been my personal colleague. When he was injured, I happened to treat him. And he said, he gave me a list of things to be done in KM Hospital. I could not do even three of that. That was an unfortunate situation. But dear friends, do you know that hospital and health centers are the soft targets for placing bombs and explosives? And it can happen at one explosion followed by a second explosion because they know that the victim will be taken to the hospital. So from these point of view also, today we have the best of police personnel with us. And let's hear from them how we can go about this. So you want to add anything more? Yeah. Now, Shri K.K. Pathak sir, the Commissioner of Police, and let us put a big congratulatory applause. Today I heard that he has been now also become the Director General of Police. So, has Pakistan been able to come till just now or not yet? Not yet, fine. I hope that he'll be able to join us. But he was going to talk about ITC provisions. And Dr. Neeraj Nagpal, who is the president of Medical Legal Action Group, from all the way traveling from Chandigarh, hasn't yet landed, but will be with us. Oh, yes, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So, Neeraj, please, it's all yours. The stage is yours. And to give you a recap about Neeraj, an internal medicine colleague from Ludhiana, a fellow of International Medical Sciences Academy, is holding the current position of Director, Gastrointestinal Diagnostic Clinic from Chandigarh. He's also a convener of Medical Legal Actions Group. He has been an ex-president of IMA. Has a number of publications, as most of us who are on the academic side have. He has edited a book, and that's important, Compendium of CPA Medical Judgments, that gives a different insight to his presentations. So, Neeraj, over to you to listen from you the various cases that happen.
So, I will have to tell my wife I entered the hall and nobody noticed me entering. So, that's something I'll get some advantage next time I'm being served dinner. Of how doctors are treated. The next to God is something which is dished out to us when it suits the society. But what the factual situation, ground reality is, this is the next to God. I wonder when the God was beaten up like this for not doing what the persons demanded. So the topic given to me was violence against medical practitioners, where, how, when. Sir, I'm in the habit of speaking for too long, so you will get a crick in the neck. Either you turn the chairs or... So I usually have to be thrown off the stage, so feel free whenever you want. A violent society is detrimental to the practice of humane medicine. We have been taught many things in our MBBS, we have been taught many things in our post-graduations. We emulate what we saw in our seniors, but our seniors had not witnessed what our generation is witnessing. And violence against doctors negates all achievements of modern medicine. You can keep doing as many angioplasties, you can keep putting 6 stents in one artery, but the fact remains, the way violence has come in, and the way we are not recognizing violence against doctors as a major illness, I still say we are not recognizing this as much, it is not getting the importance that it should. I have always wondered when we will all wake up. This gentleman, his wife was treated by this doctor. 1 year later he comes, he gets himself examined, then he gets up and stabs the doctor. I have always wondered, is some doctor someday going to die, then we will wake up? Well, one doctor already has died out of violence. There's another doctor who committed suicide in court, but that was on being convicted for PCP and DT Act. But this lady doctor, she was an anesthetist, she was working in ESI hospital, she referred to a private hospital and the lady died. This guy came with 3 other guys and with swords, and they cut her body. There were 9 sword slashes found on her when postmortem was done. But the point is, if I start listing the individual instances of violence, it is that's the end of the talk. So I have simply tabulated some of the recent incidences which have grabbed newspaper headlines. Mind you, 90% of the incidences do not come in newspapers. It is only 10% which do. And of those, a few prominent ones I have listed. And these are all recent, 2015. Just to give you an idea of the quantum of the problem. IMA, National IMA headquarters says 75% of the doctors have faced violence at work. This is a friend of mine, Dr. Rohit Gupta, also a gastroenterologist at Allahabad. He was brutally beaten up. Is violence unique to Indian healthcare scenario? It isn't. Israel, there was data, long waiting time. They have actually studied why violence occurs. Long waiting time, dissatisfaction with treatment, disagreement with physician, all these they tabulated as the reasons why violence occurs. US, 106 healthcare workers died in 10 years. Of these, 26 were physicians, and this was because of violence. America has gun laws. Anybody and everybody who wants to carry can carry a gun. And many physicians are routinely threatened, not with a lat or a baseball bat, but with a gun. The Bureau of Labor Statistics data, it shows that healthcare and social assistant workers were victims of approximately 11,370 assaults by persons in 2010. Unfortunately, in India, we just do not have the data. The lists I prepare are just indicative. We just do not have how many incidences of violence. You have an ICD code, but I'm sure in KEM Hospital, Bombay also, sir, you would not be documenting the number of incidences of violence which occurred in KEM Hospital in a particular year. This is something we have to start recognizing. And mind you, emergency medicine, the doctors who work in emergency medicine faced it, 93% of those said they have faced violence. Psychiatry, 90% of them. Family practice, 78%. Internal medicine, 71%. Pediatrics, 64%. This is USA, not India. Lancet issued an editorial. There was a major paper which was published in Lancet in 2010. Chinese doctors are often victims of terrible violence. A doctor nurse was fatally stabbed because the patient, by the son of a patient who died of liver cancer 13 years ago. pediatrician had to jump from third or fourth floor of the building to save himself once the neonate died. And Lancet issued an editorial in 2014. The scale and frequency and viciousness of attacks on medical professionals in China has shocked the world. This was the editorial. Besides physical violence with medical professionals, there is of course the issue of vandalism, where hospital equipment, hospital furniture, premises, building is damaged. In Punjab, we recently had a nursing home which was burnt, and the house of the physician also was burnt with his children and wife inside. They were saved, but we also have documentation of these kinds. Government, in its wisdom, came up with Prevention of Violence Acts. I am not very impressed with these. There are 20 states which have Prevention of Violence Act as of date. In Punjab and Haryana, on behalf of Medical Legal Action Group, under RTI, I contacted all senior superintendents of police, all DGPs, and I asked them, ki from 2010 till 2015, can you please give me the number of complaints which have been filed under Prevention of Violence Act by you? Number one. Number two, how many of these complaints you converted into FIR? And number three, how many of these FIRs were cancelled because of a compromise? And number four, how many people were actually penalized under these acts? Not one. 5 years, not one. No one has been penalized. Complaints, innumerable. Violence, innumerable instances. Some of them result in complaints. Most of the complaints, because there is a cross complaint, there is somebody has died, so the patient party also makes a complaint, the hospital also makes a complaint, the police official sits, oh, doctor saab, tusi sajay, oh, kar lo, samjhota kar lo. Samjhota kya hota hai ji? Tusi enu kuch de deo, te sanu bhi kuch de deo. So you effectively end up paying the patient also and the police official also, and you have been harassed already so much and you have been beaten. You say, to hell with it, let me get away from it. So these are the compromises which happen. But what are the causes? Actually, if you look at this very poor image of the medical profession today, from Hippocrates to the modern doctor, the image is well entrenched in society's mind. And the newspaper headlines, Calcutta recently, there was a newspaper headline, medics lynch man at Calcutta College over a mobile theft and kills him. What was found later? This was a medical college, its hostel, there were some workers who were working in the hostel mess. They had indulged in violence, they had fought. But what was the newspaper headline? Medics lynch man at Calcutta College. It was the doctors who were blamed. Routine newspaper headlines, routine TV headlines, all of us are well aware. Actually, the press is very happy publishing 45 newspaper items or newspaper reports on front page, each totaling around 300 words, and this is an actual incident. Dr. Sanjay Saruja's case, Chandigarh, he had applied a plaster. A patient went into compartment syndrome. Fishotomies were done, finally patient landed with an amputation. Times of India published 45 newspaper reports on this case in 1 year. I went to Press Trust of India against Times of India. I complained to them. Well, that is another story in itself. But the basic problem remains, what is important, what we should not forget, what we should be highlighting, the government just does not spend on health. And the responsibility of all the problems is thrown on the qualified doctors of modern medicine. Either it says they don't work in villages, or it says they do negligent acts, or this impression is thrown that they are only after money. But we are not after money. Why? Where is your budget? You have not been putting any money into health. your total expenditure, do you know we have only 25,000 primary health centers all over the country? Then you tell me there are no doctors to go there. 55,000 MBBS doctors are being produced every year. There is only 2,700 vacancies of MBBS doctors in primary health centers. How the hell does government say MBBS doctors don't go there? Any post which is advertised is applied for 10, 12, 13 times by MBBS doctors. In government hospitals, there is prolonged waiting, and violence is now no longer restricted to private sector. Safdarjung Hospital, 20 stretchers for 10,000 patients. OPD patients per day, 10,000. How many stretchers? 20. This is newspaper headline. And with a fractured leg, the person has to drag herself up the stairs to go and show in the OPD. Obviously, tempers are going to be high. But then who is to blame? Why blame the doctor? He is not going to go down and he is not going to buy the stretcher from his salary and provide. There is lack of faith in the judicial system and police to redress a genuine grievance. Patients sometimes and the relatives sometimes feel that if we go and make a complaint against the doctor, doctor ki to bada sukh hai, ye khila lega paise puse, janta hai sabko, so kuch nahi hoga. Police kuch nahi karegi, hum hi kuch kar rahe hain, chalo bhai. So they decide to take law into their own hands. But reason for that is because they have a confidence ki the police or the judiciary will not give them justice. This impression, I don't know how to remove. But then they also have total faith in police and judiciary. That if in a mob they assault the doctor, they will also not be prosecuted. They are very well conversant with this. So they have no faith that they will get justice if they complain against the doctor. But they have complete faith that if they take law into their own hands, no action is going to be taken against them. And rightfully so. Mob mentality, low health literacy, and weakness of the medical